Warning, the following contains explicit language and subject matter that may not be suitable for younger listeners, church folk, and people who enjoy kale smoothies.
Money cannot buy the honor which you have earned tonight. You make us all proud. Only effort, discipline, loyalty earn the right to wear the dragon doji. You are here because the outside world rejects you. This is your family. I am your father. I want you all to become full members of the foot. There is a new enemy. Freaks of nature who interfere with our business. You are my eyes and ears. Find them. Together we will punish these creatures. These turtles.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to A Pod Amongst Men. I'm your host, Steve B. This is Coffee Break Conversations for the 21st Century. Tonight, I have a long-awaited guest, someone that I've been following for a little while now, someone I'm very, very happy to have on the show. I would like to welcome Domino, host of the Domino Effect Podcast and one of the hosts of the Three Ninjas Podcast, as I know you motherfuckers have all heard me talk about them before on this show. What's up, brother?
Ain't nothing, man. I ain't got a complaint worth air, man. You've been waiting to talk to me, man. Let alone me.
Yeah. You know, it's one of those things, like, when you listen to a podcast, you listen to somebody talk every week about, and all, you start to put pieces together about, like, who the person is. You start, like, feeling like you get to know them. And I listen to so much of your shit now. I feel like I know you, and I'm like, you know, they don't know who the hell I am. So if I was to, like, run up on somebody, like, yo, you know, how's everything going? I heard this and that was going on. And they'd be like, who the fuck are you, bro?
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, it's really weird. It's that one-way relationship, you know? So, but no, man, I'm really happy to have you on the show. I'm happy to get to talk to you.
Happy to be on the show, man. I'm a fan, man, so I'm happy to do stuff like this.
Hey, man, I appreciate that very much. So let's just kick right off. Why don't you tell the listeners a little bit about you, about, like, where you come from, like, what your backstory is.
A little bit about me, shit.
Like, as a person, who's Dom? Who's the guy behind the ninja mask? You know what I'm saying?
Right. Let's see. Domino is just a kid from Bridgeport, born and raised in Bridgeport. Grew up, you know, kind of okay. Bridgeport, Connecticut. When people think of Connecticut, they think of, you know, everything is like a cardigan sweater or like yacht parties. Like, nah, it's a couple places in the CT that's fucked up. And I grew up in one of them. Luckily, I made it out unscathed. I'm not in jail. I'm not a statistic like everyone else. Yeah, grew up in Bridgeport. My upbringing was pretty cool. I grew up in one of the most notorious hoods in Bridgeport. I haven't fact checked this, but what people tell me, like a lot of like older people tell me, is that like in like the early 90s or whatever, like, per capita, Bridgeport was one of, like, the worst cities in America to be in. And I grew up in one of those hoods that, you know, definitely heightened that statistic. After about, like, age 3, I moved out of there. I only moved, like, a block away, so it wasn't that far of, a difference. Upbringing was pretty cool. I grew up with my mother, my uncle, and my grandfather.
You got any siblings?
I was the only child for 12 years, and then my sister came about. So I was the only child for 12 years. Upbringing was pretty cool. To keep me out of the streets, because my mother had grew up with a lot of that stuff that was going on outside with, like, the drug dealing, like, the murdering and stuff like that. She put me in a lot of sports.
Okay.
So growing up, I played basketball, I played baseball, I played tennis. She never let me play football. She said I was too, like, I guess, brittle and, like,
She told you?
I mean, as I got older, I was like, Ma, I wanted to play baseball. Then as I got older, I asked her, like, why you never let me play baseball? And she told me because I thought you was going to get hurt, like, demolished out there. I was like, damn, you really thought of me as, you know, a weakling. But yeah, I used to play football with kids around the neighborhood and be okay. I used to get, like, hit, tackle football, you know, all that type of stuff. But I guess, say, you know, I'm her son. I'm her baby. So,
that's what mothers do. Well, I was judging by your pictures, you seem like a pretty good-sized dude. You know, I'm surprised at that.
I mean, yeah. I mean, like, I grew up, you know, I eat well, you know, but, you know, I guess at age, five, my mother didn't think I was that, you know, I was ready for that. She said, you know what, you're tall, you're slender. Let's put you in basketball for right now.
Yeah.
Yeah, like I said, I grew up with my grandfather, my uncle. My uncle has autism, so I had to deal with that early on and trying to figure that out and what that was. That was a hard thing to grasp at first. And life was okay until around maybe early teens, maybe about 14, when my grandfather passed away. And then that's when life got real. Being in a household where you got multiple incomes coming in, and then once the main income leaves and everything's a struggle now, you gotta, you know, figure out how you're gonna eat, you know, how you getting here and there. You know, just when you lose that support system, everything just goes to shit. And that's when, you know, I started dibbling dabbling, like, in trouble. I guess I was out in the street more, you know, doing things that could land me in jail, could get me killed, could get me in a lot of trouble, period. Yeah, I hate when girls, like, ask you that question, like, tell me about yourself. Like, what the hell?
I know. Tell you? It's a lot. You can go, like, super deep, or you can keep it on the surface. You can go anywhere.
Yeah.
But,
yeah, go ahead.
No, I was saying, so what would you say, like, because obviously we have a lot of shared interests, you know, like, you, with Three Ninjas, like, that is a nerd-based podcast, and, you know, between you and Bobby and Hesh, like, you know, all you guys have pretty strong nerd credentials, you know, in terms of the stuff you like. Like, was that something that you have always been into? Was there someone that turned you on to like, the first thing you could think of that was in that realm? Like, how did that come about?
The first thing I remember being into was the Ninja Turtles. And I'm not sure how I found it, how I got into it. I think my mother got tired of me bothering her one day and just sat me down in front of the TV and said, watch this shit and leave me alone. And then I just got engulfed in it from day one. And then ever since then, I've been picking up, you know, broomsticks and trying to swing them like Donatello. I've been trying to, you know, put stuff together and swing nunchucks like Michelangelo.
Who's your favorite turtle?
My favorite turtle growing up was Michelangelo, because he was like the goofy one. You know, he always cracked jokes, you know, the PC and cool dude. As I got older, I started to like Leonardo more. But then now I realize I'm more Raphael than anybody. Like, I'm a hothead and I can't control my anger sometimes. But I'm a good guy once you get to know me type thing.
No, I buy that. That's, like, that's Raphael through and through.
Yeah, like, you know, he has his wild side, but he's also like the most loyal guy once you get him on your team. 100%.
Yeah, I'm more of a Donatello guy myself.
Oh, the tech guy.
Yeah, I wear glasses and shit, and I could swing a bow staff pretty good. So right. that's where I fall on that one.
Mm.
So that was the same thing for me too. I got into Ninja Turtles, I think preschool, and then when that movie came out, and what was it, 1990? The first movie. Man, that shit, like, completely changed my life.
Blew my mind.
And that is still, to this day, I think it's got to be one of my favorite movies.
Oh, that's in my top five.
That holds up, dude.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
Yeah, because at that point, I thought, like, turtles were actually real. Like, I'm staring at sewers thinking turtles are going to come out this shit. But then, you know, you get older and realize, oh, them is like men in suits. Those is puppets. I was like, oh, okay. Well, I'm stupid.
But those suits were legit, though. I mean, they were actually fighting, like, the actors. They can move. Like, they had flexibility and mobility and shit.
Amazing what you put your body through for a movie or like a check or something like that.
Hey, if you ask me, it was totally worth it.
It was totally worth it because, like, what it, because like you said, it holds up now, what, almost 30 years later?
Oh, yeah.
So we're still looking at this movie like, you know, this is amazing and it's never been recreated since.
Never been.
Yeah, exactly.
Every Ninja Turtle shit they ever did since then has never held a candle to that movie.
To the first one? Yeah. Hell no.
Well, I remember that scene when they're fighting Shredder on the roof at the end.
My favorite.
The soundtrack to that. I actually found, like, somebody, like, had it on a YouTube video, And I saved it. I ripped it off YouTube and I like chopped it. So I just repeated it on a loop for like 10 minutes and I put it on my gym playlist. I listened to that on the treadmill. And I told my buddy Drew and I think AJ was with me, but I told them about it and they didn't seem to think that was something to be proud of.
The coolest thing in the world. Like, whatever.
I'll tell you
I like it.
That shit gets me jacked.
Right.
So what started with the, how'd you start with the podcasting? Like, how did that come about? Were you like a podcast listener first or like what inspired you to begin?
Oh man.
Is this going back? You started Domino Effect like 5 years ago, right?
Yeah. I started Domino Effect in 2015. I want to say 2015 or 2014. I always wanted to be on the radio. Like, I like to talk shit, as you can tell when you listen to my podcast. I like to talk shit, and I'm not the guy that sits on social media all day and types with my thumbs like, I need you to hear me.
Mm-hmm.
So the gradual progression was, I need you to hear me, but how am I going to get heard? I didn't go to school for broadcasting. My financial aid won't allow me to go to school anymore until I paid that off. And then one day I just heard this thing called podcasting. I was like, what the fuck is a podcast? How do you podcast? And then you get an iPhone and then you see the app on the phone. Mm-hmm. And at that time you couldn't delete it. So naturally you go looking at it and seeing like, oh, what the fuck a podcast? So now you go into it and it's not actual radio recordings. It's just someone with a microphone and somehow they upload it to however they uploaded it. Whether it be like Z Share and that you had to put it on this site and do like a whole bunch of tricks to get it up on podcasts, especially Apple. And I thought for like years and years, it was like some intricate thing. Like you had to have like money to actually put a podcast together. But then when I actually sat down and Googled, how do you podcast or how do you record a podcast? And to see that you only need maybe at bare minimum a mic and just a device to record yourself. It can be the lowest quality ever. It can be, you know, just on a grand scale, like I guess with radio. But as long as you record it and then you upload it or something, it can be a podcast. So at that point, I had the idea, like, you know what? I'm going to try this out since, you know, like I said, I'm not the guy that sits on social media all day and types. So started that. And at first, I started on one podcast that didn't go so well. And then after that, I started that, I think, February 2015, when I finally buckled down and did that first one.
Mm-hmm.
That lasted all of like 2 months. And then in October of 2015, I gave myself a birthday present where I said, I'm going to start my own podcast. And then I'm going to name it the Domino. Well, Domino Effect wasn't the initial first name, but I couldn't think of one. So I just went with the name I go by. And then the Domino Effect was born. And then I guess from episode one, October 2015, I've been a quote-unquote podcaster.
Nah, man, I could tell. You definitely sound like you're very comfortable around the mic. Like, it's something that you're very used to now.
Yeah, shit wasn't easy at first, you know. Yeah, because at first you got to like the sound of your voice, and I hated the sound of my voice for so long. So
nobody liked the sound of their voice.
Yeah, exactly. So I had to get used to that first, and it was just the hustle and bustle of when I first started Domino Effect, I didn't know how to edit. I didn't know how to upload it. I just know that I record it. I have it on a file on one of my drives. I don't know how to get this shit out. So that's when Google and YouTube comes into play. And then, you know, you mess around with a GarageBand on your Mac and you figure out how to edit and do stuff. And I'm listening to other podcasts to see how they edit, where they chop this here and do this. And, you know, they up the audio here or they lower it here or they put in sound effects or whatever the fuck. And I'm taking little bits and pieces from everyone and then I incorporate that into my own show. And then the show, I guess, evolves into what it is now. You know, what it is right now, the Domino Effect, is more of an interview-based show.
Mm-hmm.
When before it was, we go over hot topics in the news, whether it be, you know, stuff about society, music, you know, pop culture, whatever the fuck. But now that I lost my other two co-hosts, it's now just an interview-based show where I just talk to people that I look up to and I have a general interest in. And that's what it is as of right now.
Okay. So who would you say like inspired you? Like, who was somebody like in that podcast realm that you listened to and kind of said, all right, that's someone who, not necessarily who I want to like emulate, but someone who I want to, you know, use as inspiration? Like, you know, maybe somebody likes Joe Rogan, one person likes Joe Budden, A lot of Joes out there. I'm just realizing now, but
right. Early on, I only subscribed to two podcasts. It was a sex podcast, and it was Bill Burr's podcast.
Billy Burr, old Billy Redface,
old Billy Blue Balls.
you saw him in the Mandalorian trailer?
Nah, I didn't.
Oh, bro, you gotta watch.
He's in the Mandalorian trailer,
dude. He's in it. He looks like a badass too. He's only in it for like one like clip, but it's enough to make you want to watch the show.
Yeah, if Bill Burr's in, I'm definitely gonna fucking watch it.
Oh, bro, you gotta watch it as soon as we're done.
Hell yeah. So, it was a sex podcast. It was called Sex Nerd Sandra. Sex Nerd Sandra and Bill Burr's podcast, right? Mm-hmm. So, Sex Nerd Sandra, she talked about sex, and she had a bunch of different guests on, whether it talked about pleasures, whether it talked about methods of sex, or, you know, just sex in general. And then Bill Burr, his was, I don't want to say less professional, but it was just a mic, a mixer, and him, and he was talking to himself.
Well, let's be honest. I mean, even now, like, he's one of the biggest stand-ups out there. It's still not very professional, but it's entertaining as fuck.
It's entertaining as fuck to hear what Bill Burr has to say when no one's around, and it's just raw audio, and it's him. He doesn't edit anything. From what I know, he leaves everything in, and he's not affected by this sensitive-ass, punk-ass culture where he just says whatever they like. I like old school shit like that. Like mm-hmm. Bill Burr. He's cut from that cloth where holds nothing back, says what's on his mind. If he goes too far, he acknowledges it, and it's just no holds barred with him. And I've been a Bill Burr fan since maybe like 2009, 2008. So when I heard he had a podcast, that's the first thing I jumped on. And then after about 2 years of just having those two podcasts, which can really fuck you up.
Yeah.
I started listening to Combat Jack, and Combat Jack did more of what I didn't know I wanted to do, where it was him in a room talking to hip-hop figures, hip-hop people that I looked up to or that I had a general interest in and wanted to get to know, and he would just chop it up, would just have, again, raw conversation about whatever. He wouldn't hold anything back. He would ask the hard-hitting questions, the questions that radio didn't ask, the unconventional questions. He would just have real conversation. Like, it wasn't an interview. It was two people, because I guess he knew a lot of people from the industry, so it was like, I know you, and we're just catching up.
Yeah.
So that, I always like those kind of conversations.
Yeah, I mean, I think the long-form conversations in that way are the things that people seem nowadays to kind of gravitate towards.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I feel like just like there's like that big pendulum swinging back the other way in terms of like censorship and having everything super professional, like you said, and it seems overdone, where it seems fake and, you know, inauthentic.
Right. You know, when you're on radio, you don't get the same person. Like, I feel like when you talk to one person, you get two different people when you interview them on radio and on podcasts. Because I've seen interviews on Joe Rogan, and then I've seen those same people on interviews in radio, and it seems like it's totally different people.
Yeah.
Like, it seems like, you know, Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde type thing.
Well, you know what's fucked up? I started seeing this in like the last, well, I guess in the last couple of years, but when somebody's like maybe on like a promo tour or something, they're marketing like some new movie or whatever, they might go on three or four different podcasts.
Mm-hmm.
And then if you actually, I end up sometimes, like Edward Norton was just on like three different podcasts. He's promoting a new movie. Yeah, he was on Rogan. He was on Nerdist, and he was Chris Hardwick's, and he was on Mark Maron's. And I'm listening, and he's telling the same story on all three.
Right.
I remember when a while ago, Al Gore came out with a movie, and he was doing a bunch of podcasts, and he did the same thing. And like Al Franken, before he quit the Senate, he was promoting a book, and he was telling the same fucking story on all these different podcasts. I was like, dude, like, the whole point of this shit is to be real and just have a conversation with people. And even now, you have what, an hour and a half worth of fucking rehearsed material here?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's what happens when, I guess, because a lot of the radio personalities or like the real professional people are bringing their personalities onto podcasts, and I don't think that necessarily works the same. I guess because, you know, when you take like a Mark Maron, I guess that podcast is that self-owned, or is that under another company?
No, that's all him.
Well, when it comes to him, I guess from the world he comes from, I guess how he's used to interviewing, or like his style of interviewing, I guess it's just, it's, you shouldn't take the same approach. And I don't know why some people choose to, when they know that this is like a free form thing. And with radio, you know, you got your points that you have to hit, you have to promote, you have to do this. You only have a certain allotted amount of time. With podcasting, it could go on for 3 hours and you can talk about whatever. And then like, oh yeah, you got a movie coming out. So what about that?
Yeah. It just felt like certain people are just using that. They're not really, they're not using it for what it's meant for. They're not just being, you know, having a conversation with someone.
I mean, you can tell who's really true to this thing and not.
I agree.
You can tell who's in it because it's the quote unquote popular thing now. And then like, oh, now at first they looked down on the podcasters as, you know, the people that couldn't get on radio.
Mm-hmm.
Now you want to be one of us and you are on radio. You have a well-paying job. You have a television platform. You have a radio gig. But why do you want to do podcasting? Because either that's an extra check or you feel left out that you're not with like the cool kids now. Like the guys that you look down on are now the cool kids and now you want to be part of the clique.
Yeah, the young kids overtook the old guys.
Exactly.
So what's the journey like in terms of starting the podcast? Because I'm sure we're probably going to have a lot of the same stories, of like, especially like horror stories about what trying to get guests and trying to promote the podcast could be like. Mm. You know, it's like a fun nightmare, as I could describe it. Like, oh. I love doing it. I wish I started earlier, but it can be a big headache, man.
Man, it's been like that for about 5 fucking years, and I honestly don't regret any of it. I take it as a compliment a lot of times when people look at me and think they can do podcasting, and I take it as a compliment because they say I make it look easy. And when you actually do the shit and, you know, see how much time and effort, and it's not just recording it, putting it up and posting it once online and then you get 1,000 views, it's never that fucking easy. Mm-hmm. I remember first episode I did of the Domino Effect, I posted it up and in like a week I got 1,000 listens. I was like, oh, I'm fucking lit. So this shit is easy. Next episode, 80 listens.
Yep.
I'm like, okay, so what the fuck am I doing wrong? So I got to approach this a different way now. And now that I know, I guess I would know the ins and outs of podcasting when it comes to like artwork and days that you put out your show and times that you put out your show, and I guess promotion and getting guests on the show and, you know, all the stuff it takes to build an audience and to build just that resume of, I'm someone that you should take the time out to listen to type thing. It's never an easy thing. It takes a lot of money. I'm in a hole, a lot of fucking money. Like, it's ridiculous how much I've lost, but the experience and the people that I've met and the friendships that I got are priceless at this point. I was basically paying to meet people and talk to them.
Mm-hmm.
I would, you know, come in the studio. I would drop my money for the studio time. I would interview people that sometimes wouldn't show up. So I pay for the studio. Sometimes they don't show up. You know, sometimes it's their fault. Sometimes it's, you know, just the world and how it works. You know, you pay money for promotion. You get sponsors. You know, sometimes they fuck with you. Sometimes they pay you on time. Sometimes they drop out. You know, like I said, I had 2 co-hosts at the beginning. They eventually left. And then when they left, I made a promise to myself that I wouldn't leave if they left, because I didn't want to give up on myself. Because when people tend to give up on you like that, you tend to have this, I guess, not a vendetta. Well, I guess it's a vendetta. Like you want to prove them wrong.
Like a chip on your shoulder.
Yeah, like a chip on your shoulder. So you want to prove them wrong. Like, hey, with or without you, I'm good. I don't fucking need y'all for anything. And I was basically doing that by myself for 3 years. Like, I was doing everything. I was getting the guests, booking the studio. I was interviewing the guests. And I don't know shit about interviewing. I just know that I have a guest. They're coming to the studio. I got to have something to ask them. And I'm going to do some research on them. Maybe check an Instagram, a Twitter, a website, whatever the fuck, Google. And I got to come up here with something compelling. I don't want to ask them the same 8 things they've been asked in other interviews. You know, the same boring question. Just something to spice it up. Something. I got to be different. I want to, you know, have that. I want to leave like a lasting mark on you. So I want to. So when you leave the show, like, huh, that was a good show. I wouldn't mind coming back and just chopping it up and just chilling with you,
yeah,
shooting the shit with you.
Yeah, you always want to leave the guests feeling like, oh yeah, you know what, that was a good time. I could do that again.
Mm-hmm.
I myself have been lucky enough. I don't think anybody's left here saying like, oh, fuck that motherfucker.
Right.
So I want to circle back around to something we touched on for a minute, and then I kind of jumped to something else. But the stuff that we would consider like nerd interests, you know, like the movies, the comic books, the anime, you know, all that stuff. When you started getting into that when you were young, you know, usually around like, you know, up until the age of like young teens, you know, everybody's into the same shit.
Right.
But right around high school, like middle school, high school is where, you know, things start to change and you start getting that like pecking order with the kids and, you know, you start making fun of the people who are different. You know what I mean?
Mm.
Did you ever feel like the stuff that you were into was stuff that you couldn't share with other people? Kind of, you know, that like you almost like you were a little embarrassed to be open about liking stuff.
Yes and no.
Okay.
It's the type of thing where you know who to divulge certain things to. Like, you know your certain group of friends that maybe aren't into the anime shit or the cartoon shit, and you know your group of friends that like, you know, Dragon Ball and Ninja Turtles and Transformers and Naruto and stuff like that. So you know who to come to with certain things. Like, growing up, I had certain homeboys that, you know, all they wanted to do was hustle and get money. I had certain homeboys, all they wanted to do was play sports. I had certain homeboys, the only thing they wanted to do is watch, you know, Cartoon Network and Toonami.
Mm-hmm.
So I know if I want to geek out, I go to them. If I want to play ball, I go to them. If I want to get some money, or if I want to just be like, yo, how do you do that? How do you get money? How do you, you know, do all this stuff? I go to them. And it's just that pecking order of, you know, I know who to bring certain things to. I didn't really get picked on at all. Most of the friends or most of the people I kept in my circle really like the same things. Like, we can talk about who won the game last night and did you watch when Goku battled Frieza. Like, we can talk about stuff like that. When it came to like bullying and getting picked on like that, none of that ever happened. I just never carry myself as like the awkward geeky guy. Like, don't let the fact that I like Pokemon get you fucked up type of thing. So, you know, it was never a thing like that. I can, you know, go play basketball, play rec, and then I can break out my Pokemon cards type of thing. It wasn't, because I had my cousins. They always liked, you know, Dragon Ball and anime. They actually introduced me to anime, actually. Like, I had my friends around the hood that, you know, like I said, they liked Transformers. They liked G.I. Joe, Thundercats, Ninja Turtles, Pokemon, you know, stuff like that. And it was never a problem. It was just a problem trying to get girls to like you.
Yeah.
Because when you bring that stuff out in the open. Yeah, when you bring that out in the open in school, they ain't really trying to run to the guy with the Charizard card.
Yeah.
So it's a thing of...
Yo, I made the mistake one time. I think I was like a freshman in high school. And Pokemon was like... It was still popular, but it was long enough after Red and Blue came out that it was kind of like the initial... You know, all was faded, and I don't. Was something I ended up having like a fucking like a little keychain. I'm just like, yeah, I put it in my backpack. It's a Squirtle. It's pretty cool,
right,
bro? I fucking walked into the cafeteria and motherfuckers saw that Squirtle, dude. They ripped the piss out of me, bro. They were relentless. I was like, all right, new rule: never mention this to another human being as long as I live.
You got to keep that shit to yourself. You got to keep your geekdom on the low sometimes.
Well, that's that day I learned. I'm like, all right, I do not talk to people about this. And then, you know, I was into art when I was in high school. So I used to stay after, and I had like kind of like an extra credit art class. So it was like me and all these people I didn't know. A lot of Asian kids were in there. And then I realized, oh, wait, you guys watch Gundam Wing?
Right, like, right. Shit.
I'm like, okay, I can talk to these guys.
But it was also at a certain point where I didn't give a fuck. Like, it was, you're not going to shame me for liking what I like. Like I said, don't let the fact that I like this get you fucked up. Like, you're not going to push me around, try to take my stuff, try to demean me because I like what I like.
Nah.
I know I can still relate to you on other things, but because this is what you see of me, This isn't all of me. Like, people like to make that misconception, like, just because they see this one facet of you, they think that's all you're about. Like, no, like,
that's just,
I like a lot of other things. That's just one.
Yeah, that's just what this show is about.
Yeah, exactly.
So, but let me ask you this. Is that current Dom talking, or is that high school Dom talking?
High school Dom wasn't as confident, so he would hide, but it wasn't all the time.
Okay.
Where it was like, sometimes when, you know, you think you're at the lunch table with your friends playing Pokemon, or like you're playing, you know, you got your Game Boy out and you know, battling somebody on Pokemon and you think nobody's watching. Then, like, I guess like the cool girls walk by, or like the jocks walk by, mm-hmm. and they want to say something, or they want to try to do something to you. And then you get a little bit embarrassed because maybe that's the girl you like, and now she's seen you playing Pokemon. Now you're a fucking loser. But it's at a certain point where I got in high school where it was like, I wasn't all the way comfortable with myself, but I started being like, I really don't give a fuck. Like, I'm not ugly. Like, I still get women. It's just the fact that I like Pokemon, and just that's not the person for me. That's not the group I'm supposed to be with.
Yeah.
Because the people that, I guess, would look at me playing Pokemon or doing this or talking about this, they won't judge me. They'll be like, oh, what is that? They'll ask questions, or they'll just, you know, find something else to relate with me on. Like, that's not the only thing that I can talk about.
I'm bringing up memories now. I'm thinking that same day with the fucking Squirtle keychain. I remember this kid, Jay Ball. He was like, is that Pokemon? But like screaming. I was like, bro, why are you going to be so fucking loud?
Shut the fuck out, man. Yeah, keep it on low, man.
I thought we were cool, bro. What are you doing?
Mm.
Oh, man.
But at the same time, there could have been a kid to be like, yo, is that Pokemon? I didn't know you like Pokemon. And then y'all bond on something else.
Yeah,
or it could be that jackass that be like, dude, you fucking 15, 16, you playing Pokemon? Like,
you know what, though? That kid who might have liked it, he was smart enough to keep his mouth shut. Not like my dumbass.
And that was my thing, too. And I didn't get what the fuck I was supposed to like at that age. Like, if I'm 12, 13... playing Pokemon, or I'm talking about Gundam Wing or Dragon Ball, and you think that's the geekiest shit in the world, what the fuck is wrong with your life? Like, what am I supposed to be liking at this age? Like, I like girls, I like playing sports, I like anime, I like all this nerdy stuff, but you seem to have a problem with, like, what's fucked up in your childhood that you just don't like anything that has to do with animation or just anything fun? Like, everything in your life is so serious. Like,
yeah, well, all that bullying and the picking on people shit, that's really just a deflection. That, especially in high school, that's just the shit people don't want to be the target, so they target someone else to make sure they're not in the crosshairs, you know? I think that's really all that is. You know, those kids, who knows what it's really like at their house? Maybe they get, you know, no attention at home, or maybe the parents are douchebags, you know, and treat them like shit. They got to come to school and take it out on other kids who didn't do nothing to them. So
then you see that them same kids now, and they're all fucked up. Like, I love being on Facebook and looking at these people that were cool in high school and see how they fell off. Oh,
bro, I had to stop.
Constant
Facebook.
Joy.
I can't do it. I don't want to see who's got four kids and, you know, who's, oh, it's just too depressing, because a lot of these people that I grew up with, I look back at now, I'm like, man, I had nothing in common with anybody.
Like, and you motherfuckers peaked in high school, and that's the sad part.
Yeah. Well, luckily for me, I was a little on the more losery side in high school, so I got to peak later on.
Mm-hmm.
Like, fuck you, bitch. My wife is hotter than you. Anyway.
Exactly. Yo, that's the craziest thing. Like, the women that you wanted in high school, and you look at them now, like, ugh.
Yeah.
Like, damn, I'm glad. Like, God is always looking out somehow, some way. Like, the person that you're supposed to be with, they eventually come along.
Yeah, I mean, I think that for I don't know. See, now that gets tough, because I had a conversation about this. There's some people that just don't actually find anyone, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you see these guys, especially if we're talking about, like, people that are into, like, this kind of, like, nerd stuff. Like, there's a lot of guys who I really honestly feel like there's some guys who go through their entire life never having another human person ever touch their genitals ever.
But I feel like most of the time is their fault because.
Yeah.
Because, like I said, you can like anime and all this nerd shit. It doesn't stop women. Like, I've never had a problem getting women.
No, I would never blame it on this stuff. I think you're right. It's their fault. There's always shit that could be done, you know?
Yeah, it's always like you just happen to fit this trope of, like, maybe you're very unkempt. Maybe you just present yourself as very awkward, maybe you don't know how to talk to women, it's not because you like, you know, One Piece. it's never because of that.
I agree 100%. No, that's a lot. I see that a lot, though. I see these guys, and instead of actually taking a look at themselves and seeing, like, maybe what can I be doing different? Mm. It's always, you know, who can I blame? This is not my fault. It's women's fault. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like that, I can't fuck with anybody who's doing that. Especially
the whole incel community, too.
Yeah, man. And it's scary because, you know, a lot of guys, I was just listening to this. This guy was talking about this on Tom Segura's podcast today. But there's a lot of guys are find themselves, this is what this podcast is kind of about, is in this gray area nowadays. You know, over the past like 50 plus years, women as a gender have been making these huge strides, and, you know, in society, you know, going to school, getting better jobs, you know, they're not just stay-at-home moms, you know, they have careers and they're making lives themselves, and a lot of times they don't need a fucking man.
Right, right.
And as men, we kind of find ourselves, well, what are we supposed to do? I mean, I always thought, like, everything I did in my life was just to get women. And if now they're saying they don't need me, where does that leave me now?
Yeah, where do I fit in the equation?
Exactly. And that's one of the reasons you see such high suicide rates in men, and, you know, such high rates of depression. You know, like, guys are angry. And I think a lot of that, I mean, for lack of a better term, they kind of find themselves in a useless position. You know what I mean? I don't know how the fuck I got into that.
That takes a lot of soul searching because a lot of people want to blame the world, but they don't look inside themselves first and see what's wrong and see what could you possibly be doing wrong? What are you presenting to the world? Why are you so angry? Why do you feel like this, that, and the third? Once you do that soul searching and find out, like, maybe I can take accountability for this aspect. Maybe the world is that fucked up, but this part, I can take some accountability for, I can change that. I can, you know, flip this 180 and, you know, make a positive change out of it. You don't have to resort to such extreme measures of, like, you know, depression and then, like, the ultimate being like suicide and stuff like that. You can all you have to do, but it takes, I don't know what type of like come to realization moment that it takes to actually get there, but it has to come sooner than later, hopefully.
Yeah, it just got to start somewhere. I think as long as somebody could start with like one thing. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of times, and I know everybody knows somebody like this. So I think I'm kind of spitballing this right now. So bear with me.
Right. No,
so think of like a person you know in your life, and they always got to like start shit, or they're always surrounded by drama. They're always doing something fucked up. And then when it, you know, shit goes bad for them, like, oh, you know, I never catch a break. Everybody's always out to get me. You know what I'm saying? They play the victim. But then when you look at it, it's like, well, the common denominator in all these situations is you, and you make bad decisions. And it's like, it's not that easy for some people to just, like we said, take a look in the mirror, you know, look inward. Like, maybe there's something I'm doing wrong. If the same shit keeps happening over and over, the only common is me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've been having to do that for like the past 6-7 years, because when stuff goes bad, first thing I look at is me. Like, did I have something to do with this ultimate outcome? And if I feel like I did, I just, you know, sit down and have that conversation with myself. Next time that arises, I try to do better.
Yeah, no, but that's like a mature, responsible thing to do. You know, as we know, not everybody is fucking...
Not everybody's on that same plane with you.
Oh, excuse me. We already established that you can't blame someone's interest, like nerd culture and stuff, for toxic behavior. You know what I'm saying? You don't think, I don't really believe that there's any kind of causality there between, it's kind of like people saying like the violent video games make people want to do mass shootings. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Like it's a very shitty connection at best. Mm-hmm. I think.
How they used to say, like, Marilyn Manson made kids want to shoot schools up, and, you know, Grand Theft Auto is the reason why, you know, kids shoot up schools, or, you know, why they take the anger out the way they do. Like, no, maybe they're just fucked up individuals that had a bad break and, you know, they just happen to play this game. It's not like, I don't think the two have ever been correlated, you know, where it's like, oh, somebody shoots somebody with an AK and blows up a car and gets chased by the police and Grand Theft Auto. Now they feel like they can do it in real life if they just take out all their problems on someone in school and shoot up a school and kill 8 people. And now they feel like, oh, because the game did it, I can get away with it and do it. Like, no, that's never been the case.
Yeah, it's like video games don't make a person violent. A person ever is violent. A shitty home life and bad parenting and, you know, constant abuse at the hands of either their parents or other kids at school. That's the shit that makes people violent.
Accountability. You know what I mean? Exactly. Nobody wants to take accountability for those kids. It's like, you know, we don't know where this kid went wrong. Oh, you know where the fuck they went wrong. You just don't want to own up to it.
Yeah, poor kid was getting his ass kicked every day just because he, you know, couldn't fucking catch a football.
Yeah, like some dumb shit like that.
Yeah, but that's all the time. But you're 100% right. Nobody wants to take responsibility or accountability for, you know, having affected that person's life.
And there's always signs beforehand where it's always like you see this kid, he's very reserved. He's, you know, he's very to himself. He doesn't communicate well. He doesn't have a lot of friends. And then when he goes off the rails, they're like, oh, I don't know what happened. He was such a good kid. Like, no, all the signs were there. You just chose to ignore him because you thought it couldn't happen here. It couldn't happen to you. Nobody you know would ever do anything like that. But, no, all the signs are always there.
And a lot of times, too, people, you know, they saw the signs, knew they were there, and they did nothing to help. You know, you might see somebody getting picked on or, you know, getting abused or someone being mistreated, and you just keep moving. It's like, well, you know, it's not my problem. I don't want to get involved because then it becomes my problem, and then it's a whole thing. It's like, but think of how far one act of, like, caring or kindness can go, especially for that person who is the target. You know what I'm saying? Like, think of how much that would mean to them that someone actually stood up for them.
All it takes is one person, and that can derail that whole situation.
Yeah, man.
If you talk to that kid that's, you know, a little standoffish, if you just say, hey, come sit with me at lunch. Hey, what are you drawing? What are you doing? You know, just simple shit. It can, you know, offset a lot of the shit that's going on now.
Bro, the Joker movie really... It's in so many ways, man. It makes me rethink a lot of things. Not necessarily, you know, I'm not like I was picking on people or I was treating somebody shitty that I'm aware of. You know, I hope there's no one out there saying, yo, fuck that motherfucker.
But, yeah, you might be next on the list and not even know it type
shit. Steve Buscemi might be crossing my name off a list somewhere with lipstick.
Right.
But, yeah, man, it just really... It really gave me a new perspective, I think. This poor guy had so much shit going wrong in his life, and people just, they didn't want to be around him because he had a condition. You know, he was a little weird, you know, but he seemed, generally kind of like a nice guy, at least in the beginning. And it was
they're always nice.
Yeah.
They're always the best people that you ever want to talk to. They may be a little weird, you know, don't get that messed up, but they're always like, they always come from a genuinely nice place.
I work with a guy, and I'm not going to say any names, but I think the guy, he has Asperger's syndrome, but was never like really diagnosed because he came from an immigrant family where there was kind of like, they didn't really address things like that. Like, no, he's okay. He's just funny like that. Don't worry about it.
Right.
But I mean, and all the signs are there, and the guy's still, you know, he's functional, he's fine, but right. You could tell that something's a little weird. And there's so many dudes that just like, yo, fuck him, he's so weird, man. That guy's fucked up. Like, no, like you're not taking a look just to look, you know, one inch below the surface here. Like, maybe it's not something that he can help. You know, he's not a bad person. Like, he's a little off. That's okay.
Yeah,
but you could be nice.
All it takes is one person to be nice. You don't have to treat everyone like an asshole because they're not like you or your group of friends.
I agree. That shit's something that's, you know, that's bothered me for years about this, especially in this one case. You know, some people, like, they're fucking mean, man. There's really no other word for
genuine
it.
Genuine assholes.
Yeah, they're just mean. And it's like, yo, I hate that guy. Why? How could you hate the guy? Like, what did he ever do to you? It's like, well, he's nothing. Annoying. I was like,
just exist.
Yeah. Okay, so maybe you're the piece of shit. Maybe I don't need to be talking to you anymore.
Exactly. I'm gonna go talk to the weird guy.
Yeah. All right. So
he's cool.
Let's change gears a little bit. Make it something a little more fun. So since we're still on nerd culture and stuff, what's your feeling on like a lot of nerd culture things, like a lot of comic book movies are out now. Obviously, Marvel changed the game. Mm. Like nerd culture really has kind of pushed its way into the mainstream in terms of pop culture and you know what's going on in the grander scheme. What's your perspective on that? Like, do you feel like it kind of cheapens it? Like, do you feel protective of some of these like franchises? You know what I'm saying? Like,
I mean, at first I felt a little protective of, oh, now y'all want to jump on the bandwagon now that you have a visual representation of what the fuck we've been reading and watching on cartoons for all these years. Now you want to jump on a bandwagon and like, oh, I'm a fan of Spider-Man or Iron Man now. Like, I mean, it's okay that everyone, you know, wants to come in and be a part of the cool crowd, but it's just like, where the hell was y'all? And, you know, like 5-10 years ago when we was just strictly reading this in comic books or watching an animated series on TV, whatever. It's cool, but I guess the people that are into it now that weren't before, they finally get what we've been doing all these years, because now, like I said, they have a visual representation. It always takes someone to actually see something to believe it. Like, oh, this is what you guys been reading.
Yeah.
Now I can take what's on this comic book and now it's being enacted on screen. Now I see what you guys like, and now that makes me want to read the comic books. Because a lot of times when, you know, people read books and they always say the book is better than the movie, and the book always has more detail, more, you know, lines that they left out of the movie, or just like certain little plots or plot holes and, you know, and certain stuff. It's just the fact of, you know, now it's in a medium that people can digest. Because when it comes to comic books or like animation, everybody thinks of it as, you know, something for kids.
Yeah.
And now that, you know, you put it on a stage when it comes to like movies and stuff like that, something that's digestible for everyone, because everyone watches movies, I would hope. And it's something that where you see plot lines and explosions and character development and, you know, storylines and all this cool stuff. Now it's like, oh, so this is from this comic book. This is what you guys been into. And I didn't know until I actually saw it on screen. Like, oh, this makes sense now. But
yeah, I had to have that conversation with my son. A friend of the family had an old stack of all these old comic books, and they were anywhere like Marvel, DC, freaking, they had like Dark Horse comics and like Valiant stuff in there. Right. Just mm-hmm. a random fucking mix of shit. And I was opening them with him. I'm like, oh, look at this. This is like an old X-Force. I'm like, mm-hmm. check this out. And he's like, what is this? I'm like, yo, these were kind of like the X-Men, only they did their own thing. They were a little darker. Like Deadpool is here. Here's Cable. And he's like, how come are these guys in the movies? I'm like, no, listen, there's a whole bigger world. Like, you don't mm-hmm. even understand. And I'm realizing like this, a lot of people now, like they're seeing the big screen versions, and it's just, they only like that. And a lot of people just don't have appreciation for, you know, with the larger world of what it really is, where it comes from. Even something like Star Wars, you know, like Star Wars, there was a ton of books, there was the graphic novels, there's a huge universe that exists there, and the people just kind of only want to, you know, dip their toe in a little bit, and it's like, oh, I really love Star Wars. Like, oh, okay, so you know, like, you could name a couple members of the Jedi Council? No, what am I, a fucking nerd? All
right, bro. I'm starting to get into Star Wars now, and what turned me off to Star Wars were the fans of Star Wars.
They're the worst.
I felt like they went too over the top when it came to the movies coming out, because I didn't know that, because in the 90s when these movies came out, when like Episode 3 and like the Clone Wars and all that shit came out, I didn't get the excitement. Like, I had seen Star Wars, but I was like, why is everyone, you know, going to the cons or going to the movies, mm-hmm. matter of fact, dressed in like Jedi gear or like Darth Vader helmets and outfits? I'm like, yo, what the fuck is the lore about? Like, I don't get all of this. But then when you actually sit down, take it all in, you know, you research certain stuff, you start reading the books, you start watching, you know, the series on Cartoon Network, when you start, you're actually getting into it and asking questions. And I was like, oh, I kind of get it now. It's kind of, you know, it's something that I'm looking deeper into. I'm not just, you know, writing them off as like, yo, these motherfuckers is crazy.
I remember I used to work at KB Toys. You remember that? These have them in the malls.
God damn.
Yeah.
You that old.
Yeah, no, bro. I'm a couple years older than you. I get, but I got a job as assistant manager there. So I ended up getting my boys' jobs there with me. So we ended up getting, they had like the life size, like the lightsabers that you could put like four C batteries in and light them up, and they make the sound when you hit them. So we were like 19, 20 at the time. So I got a bunch of them. I had like two of every color, and we were fucking around one night. We were hanging at my buddy's house drinking. It was like midnight. And I was like, yo, let's light these fucking things up. I got batteries. So next thing you know, we're like half in the bag, rolling around on his front lawn in like the middle of the night, fighting each other these fucking lightsabers, like bloody knuckles, like bruises on our faces from getting hit. Like it was, and then I realized, I'm like, I think we took it too far, guys.
And then the shit that you was doing for fun, you can make a career out of that now, because when I was at BlurCon, it were people that were doing synchronized lightsaber battles, and they looked cool as shit. But I was like, you know, those toys that you got from KB's or Toys R Us, now you're actually having full-on battles with them, like choreographed battles.
Let me tell you something.
Paying money to watch this, or they're just watching and throwing money in a hat. I'm like, this is ridiculous.
Let me tell you something. I did martial arts for most of my life growing up, and one of the styles I did was Shinkendo, which is Japanese sword, martial art. So I got some chops, no pun intended. But I'm like, I used to fucking train. A guy I trained with was a Star Wars fan too, and we would actually choreograph fight scenes. Like he would stay at the dojo afterwards, and we would actually make our own battles and stuff like that. Like,
wow,
that's something that I would love to do as a career. Like, be a fight scene choreographer.
Oh, that'd be dope as shit.
Especially because if you think about Star Wars, there's so many cool things they could do, especially with like Jedi powers that you never see in the movies.
Right.
Like,
I'd be thinking that a lot about Ninja Turtles too. I'd be thinking that all these people that I see online or on Instagram that are doing all these tricks with like swords and bows and nunchucks, I'm like, why haven't they ever tried to incorporate that into an actual movie about ninjas? But, you know, it's I don't know the red tape that you have to get through to do that, but I just want to see it one time.
I remember playing the Batman games, like the Arkham City and stuff, and watching the cool, like, the fight scenes that they would do in the game, and like the little cut scenes where you do like a finishing move or something.
Yeah, it like slows down as you hit them, and then you ducking and doing all that crazy stuff.
Like, how come you don't see that shit in the movie? Like, the inspiration is right there. Just do what they fucking did. How come we can't see that?
I've been saying that for the longest, that video game creators need to start making movies, and I don't know why they don't.
Ugh. You know what I think one of the closest I've seen was the first Blade movie.
Yeah. Yeah.
That
had a lot of action, and then Wesley Snipes had an actual martial arts background.
That's one of the things that ruins some of the movies now. It's like the fighting looks lame.
Right.
Like that, that did in the Iron Fist show. The fighting was fucking whack.
I forgot what, I think it was Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon, where the female was actually hitting the people that she was fighting, and it made it look so much more real, and it made it that much more exciting when I learned that behind the scenes thing. Like, she was actually like hitting the people, and people were like coming out with like bloody noses and missing teeth and stuff like that.
I'm
like,
the young girl?
I believe so.
Z Zhang, I believe.
Yeah. I believe so. And when I finally learned that fact, I didn't know why they didn't do that more in movie, but I guess there's like a clause that you can't really, like, you know, injure everyone that you work with. So I don't think you just go around hitting people, but it just made the movie that much more better when I saw it. Like, oh, she's actually hitting these motherfuckers.
Yeah, no, there's like a cloud of dust coming off this guy.
Yeah, like she really knocked the shit. Like, he's not faking on the ground. Like, he's really hurt.
We got to cut, guys. No.
Yeah.
I don't think his leg's supposed to bend that way.
Yeah, now we got to do another take. Now we got to bring in, like, another group of people to do this again.
What's your favorite of all the franchises, of any different thing?
My favorite of any franchise.
I'm just going to nerd out now for the rest of the time.
Yeah, I want to say Ninja Turtles, but I haven't been a fan of every single movie, even though Ninja Turtles is my favorite franchise of any nerd medium. I really like Transformers when I first saw it. I liked the first through the third maybe got me, where it was the thing that I had to go see in the movies.
Okay.
It was the point where they started killing off the Autobots that I actually liked.
When they killed Ironhide, I'll never forget.
Oh my God, man. When they killed Ironhide, I was like, I don't even watch this shit no more. And then they brought in like the two like stereotypical black ass robots that was talking jive and ghetto and all this shit. I was like, I don't even watch this shit.
What about
no
the
more.
First one, Jazz?
Jazz, they.
And they ripped them in half. They ripped them in half.
That was kind of hard, but for some reason I can always watch that movie when it comes on when Optimus is fighting. I can't even think of the Decepticon's name.
The one on the highway.
When he chops his head off, shit like that. Bone Crusher. Yeah, when he chops his head off, I was like, oh my God, this is the greatest movie ever. And then like the scene where he's chasing him on the highway, it looks so goddamn real. I couldn't believe the graphics on that. It was just like you know, and you know how everyone has to see like the Fast and the Furious movie when it comes out.
Oh yeah,
it was like that with Transformers. I was like, no matter, I don't give a fuck what's going on. I don't care who's the, you know, the villain or whatever. I'm going to see this movie. And then they started losing me. I was like, oh.
Well, in the second one, when he was fighting the three, he was fighting Blackout and Starscream and Megatron all at once, and he started whooping their ass too, and then they ended up killing him.
Yeah.
Like that scene, though, I remember watching that. Like, this is fucking badass.
Yeah, man. I love Transformers. To this day, I can still watch all three of those. Like, when they come on TV, I can sit down and watch those and not think about shit. But other than that, Transformers is the first thing that comes to mind. Like, Ninja Turtles 1, that comes to mind. But 2 was cool. 3 lost me.
Let's move on from three because that one doesn't exist.
Yeah, because what's the next one that came out? It was a 3D one that came out, I guess, in like the late 2000s. I think that was 07 or 06 that one came out. It was TMNT.
Oh, yeah.
I liked that one. That wasn't really like...
It was okay.
It was okay. And then when they did the CGI ones, it fucked my world up.
Yeah, it didn't work.
It didn't work at all.
No. You guys did the reviews of Game of Thrones. Like, how were you with that show? Did you like start late? Were you a fan from the beginning?
Man, I started so late on Game of Thrones. When I was with my children's mom, one night, like, she would always talk about this show, and I was like, I'm not watching this fucking show with like magic and dragons and fucking all this stuff. Yeah. So one night I couldn't sleep.
Not like my wife.
Yeah, so one night I couldn't sleep and I went into the living room and like the television just happened to be on HBO. So I turned it on. I'm like, what the fuck is this? Like, this that Game of Thrones shit she be talking about? All right, let me just watch this. I don't really want to find a remote or nothing like that, but let me just watch this shit. And then the first episode I saw, Grey Worm was fighting somebody on the top of the castle and he took a spear and he threw it and impaled like 3 people. I was like, oh shit, this black dude kind of lit. Like, I like watching this shit. So then I actually started watching the rest of the episode. And I think by the end of the episode, I was like, yo, who the fuck are all these people? And what's happening and what's going on? And then I started at season 1. And I think that was when I saw that episode, that was season 4 or 5. So I started at season 1, episode 1. And then I'm seeing people that I didn't see in the episode that I just seen that night. I'm like, oh, this fucking show gets real. Like, they killing off like real integral parts of the show. Mm-hmm. And then when I got cool with Bobby started telling me about the Red Wedding. I was like, yo, don't tell me nothing else about the Red Wedding. And then when it happened, I called him. I was like, yo, how they gonna kill my man Rob? And his wife got the baby. You gonna kill her? I'm like, man, this shit real. Yeah. And then as I'm watching, it became a thing where I started watching it when I was, by coincidence, like on vacation from work. So it was like 3 or 4 days, I didn't do shit I was supposed to do on vacation. I was just watching Game of Thrones. And I was just like stuck in the house.
I did the same thing, only I wasn't on vacation. I took off from work.
Like, it gets that serious sometimes.
Yeah. My boys were watching it, and I remember hearing them talking about it. Like, yeah, whatever. I mean, whatever. I don't really care that much. And then when the Red Wedding first aired on TV, I remember everybody talking about it. I'm like, you know, maybe I should give this thing a chance. If I catch it before the next season starts, I only have 3 seasons to catch up on. So I watched like the first episode. I was like, oh shit, all right, let me see what's on the next one. And then the second episode, next, you know, third, fourth, fifth. And I just binged the first 3 seasons. And I was like, dude.
Yeah, the first episode, they threw the fucking boy out the window. And now, yo, it, like, from the first episode, it caught me and I was hooked. I was like, so that's, so they're related. Yeah. And now this little boy is climbing his keep and he caught them and just casually pushed this motherfucker out a window. Yeah. I was like, oh, these people are diabolical. I'm watching all this shit.
Apparently the Lannisters live in the south of Westeros.
Exactly. They're straight Alabama people.
I'm just kidding, southern listeners. You guys are all right. But I'm gonna joke with you. Don't worry.
Shout out to Alabama. Roll Tide.
So yeah, I went. I actually I went. And I got the books and I read all the books back to back. And it's you know, from the first three seasons, the show is pretty damn close to the books. But after that, bro, it changes so much. Like from where the show went after the Red Wedding to where the books are, it's so fucking different.
Yeah, I definitely want to get into the books, but I don't think I have the time to actually get into the books and finish it the way I want to, because I want to sit down and read the book. Like, if I can't get the whole book done in a week, I want to get through at least half in a couple of days.
Bro, these books are like over 1,000 pages, man.
Yeah, I think if I actually sat down and read it, I'd be reading it for like 3-4 years. I just don't have the time most of the time to sit down and just read a book. Like, I barely got time to fucking sleep.
Bro, if it makes you feel any better, I was single and I lived alone when I did it, because I can't do that shit now.
Can't do that shit now. You know, women and kids, you know, they just take up all your time. And
bro, I got a book sent to me. I'm literally in the book. Like, my quotes are in the book. And
yeah, I heard about that.
I still can't finish reading it, man. Like, I haven't had the time to sit down and read this thing.
And you're in the goddamn book.
I know. Like, that says everything you need to know right there.
Sad reality, man.
Yeah. I'm doing like a little bit at a time, but I just can't find the quiet time to do it.
And congrats on that, man. That's a big accomplishment, man.
Honestly, bro, that I appreciate that, but it was pure luck, because like I got contacted by the author because she searched, you know, the iTunes directory in terms of like podcasts about like masculinity and manhood and stuff. And it just so I had like two episodes out at the time.
Right. Damn.
I'm thinking like, oh man, this could be my big break.
Right.
But no, she was super cool, and you know, she put all my words in exactly as I said them. So shout out to her. I'm happy with the way I come off in the book. But
if somebody would find my podcast and give me some goddamn money, I'm tired of working.
Bro, I didn't say I was getting paid for it.
I know, but still, like, I just want somebody to find me and like, you know, hey, I'm going to put you in a book. You know, I just happen to find your podcast and I think the world of you. So I'm just going to, you know, I just want to talk to you for a couple seconds and then something comes from it. I just want something magical like that to happen. Like, oh, you found me on iTunes or Spotify and now we're doing this. And I'm like, okay.
Listen, dude, you guys, you three, you, Hesh, and Bobby, you guys are filling a niche that as far as I know, there's nobody else filling it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and you guys are good at it. Like, you guys have, and I'm not just blowing smoke up your ass because you're my guest on the show. Like, right. I'm legitimately saying I enjoy listening to your show more than 95% of the other podcasts out there. And that's including, like, you know, the Rogans, the Charlemagnes, like all these other shows. They don't have the chemistry that you three have, and they don't feel like they're not so perfect for what they're doing. Mm. You know what I mean?
Thank you, man. Like, I appreciate that.
I think that's you guys really have a quality content.
Yeah, man. It's something that just came out of nowhere. It's just like it's something that I can't really explain. It just so happened to work, and I'm glad it's worked, and I'm glad it's reached the people that it's reached, and then the people that I guess happened to catch on like I did with Game of Thrones, where it just catches on like maybe episode 59 or something like that. I'm like, yo, I fucked around and listened to, I started at 1 and now I'm all the way caught up. I'm like, we're having an impact on people that a lot of times I don't get to see, and a lot of times when I question myself and like, am I doing something good? Is this, you know, something that people actually like? And then, you know, you have those days, I guess, as a creative or a podcast or whatever, you get down on yourself sometimes. Like, am the stuff that I'm doing, is it impacting people? Is it making a difference? Am I doing something? And then you just so happen to get that DM or that message or that comment that just lifts your spirits and be like, you know what? That's giving me my second wind to keep going and, you know, push this thing as far as I can.
Yeah, I feel- I, I've
I feel like with them, I can do whatever I need to do. I can push this as far as I can.
No, I think you guys have something. You have an X factor that a lot of people don't have, especially a lot of shows with multiple hosts. Mm. You know, you guys work well with the three of you. You're not all the same person. You know what I mean?
Right, right. Definitely not.
You each have like your individual voices that you bring to the table.
Mm-hmm.
Oh shit!
Thank you, man. I appreciate that, man.
I'm sorry. I saw a shadow moving in the mirror. I thought I had like a ghost, but it's actually the curtains flapping in the AC.
You about to shoot shit up?
Somebody almost got fucking judo chopped.
Exactly. Never know. You almost judo chopped you.
But, bro, you almost got nunchucked. You don't even know. you're 100% right though. I think anybody who's a content creator definitely has those days where it's just like, bro, nobody's listening to this. Why am I even wasting my time? You know, I could be sitting with my kid right now playing Smash Brothers or just reading a book, and I'm here, you know, on the microphone. But then, you know, like you said, like there's always like the universe knows when you need to get that, you know, that attaboy. Like somebody will reach out and tell you that they enjoy what you're doing. And like it's enough to keep you going, you know.
And it always comes at the weirdest fucking time too, because it happens to me at least once a month where I just mm-hmm. look at an episode or I'll look at what we're doing. I'm like, is this really what people want to listen to every week? And then I get that message or I get that comment, and it does something to me, and I don't even know that I need it. It just comes out of nowhere, and I don't know how these people know that I need that or we need that, and it does something to me that I can't explain. And I can't express enough how much I appreciate everyone that listens to our podcast. Like I can't put it into words what that shit means to me, because we started this on a whim, and to see where it's going, and we have listeners like all over the world. It's not even just in the States, it's all over the world. Like when we send out merch, I can't believe some of the places that we're sending these clothes to. Like, you guys listen to us, y'all download us, y'all listen to us every week faithfully. Then you decided to give your money to us. Then you want to wear something that we create and you want to listen to some content that we create. Like, it's the most humbling thing ever. And I'm always grateful and just brought back down to earth when something like that happens. Because, like I said, I really get down on myself. But then something like that happens where somebody gives me their attention or gives me their money or gives me 2 hours out of their day. And it's just always the most humbling feeling ever.
It's a beautiful feeling. And I will say this, those hoodies are comfortable as fuck, dude. Well,
yeah, I know.
Well played on wherever you got those things from.
Thank you, man. Shout out to my man, Jim.
All right. So the last thing I want to talk about, hang on. I'm going to time out 1 sec. My wife is texting me. She's getting about to get on the plane. I'm going to tell her.
Hey, go ahead.
I'll cut this out later.
Mm-hmm.
My wife just had to fly down to Miami. Her sister just had a baby. So fucking yesterday she came home from work and she's like, I think I should go. Mm-hmm. I'm like, okay, well, what's the flight? She said, 6:45. I look at the clock, it's 5:30. I was like,
shit. Yeah. Like, are you leaving right now?
Yeah, you better pack.
Yeah, right, right.
So she's coming home tonight and her flight got delayed.
So, yeah, it's raining.
Yeah. Well, and I still have work tomorrow at, you know, 7 a.m. and I have to drive 45 minutes to Newark Airport. But anyway, okay, what is this? 1 hour and 6 minutes. God damn. All right. So as I'm sure you've seen in, you know, in like the news and stuff, there's been some recent backlash. Martin Scorsese has made some comments about Marvel films not being quote unquote cinema. And then some other famous directors kind of piled on, like Francis Ford Coppola said they were despicable. What's your thoughts on this? Because my first thought was, yo, fuck you. Like, I don't like Goodfellas anymore. Go fuck yourself. But then I had to, you know, once I calmed down.
He was like, okay.
I'm like, oh, Goodfellas is still good.
And
I'm like, great
fucking movie.
Yeah. I'm an Italian from New Jersey. Like, I have to like that movie.
Right, right.
But, I really started thinking about it, and like he wrote an op-ed in the New York Times really kind of elaborating on what he was really trying to get at. And I mean, I think he's wrong about saying it's not cinema. You know, I don't think he gets to decide what's cinema and what's not. you know, it may not be something that he's into, which is totally fine.
Mm-hmm.
But he did make a point, and I can't really dispute because it was a good point. In terms, like with Marvel found the formula on how to make a movie people like to see. They enjoy it. You know, it's like we have three big action sequences throughout the movie. You know, in the action sequences, there's little bits where there's like a joke, you know, and it makes people excited and then they laugh and it's a really good feeling. And they know how to churn these movies out and make everything connected. But at the same time, you know, they're making the billions of dollars, but it's kind of taken up all the oxygen in the room. You know what I mean? Mm. It's like movie companies, they don't want to take risks. They want to stick with something that they know works. And right now, what do they know works? Superhero movies. You know what right. I mean? Like, what do you think about that whole shit?
I think it's really old people being old and not wanting to stray away from what they know and not accepting the new. Because that happens every so often when it comes to any medium you can think of, whether it be music, whether it be art, whether it be movies, whether it be, I guess, a new invention when it comes to technology. People don't like when people are at the top of their game and so successful in something, they don't like to be, I guess, overtaken, or they don't like to share the spotlight with others, mm-hmm. type of thing is what I think. Because when you think of Martin Scorsese, you think of, you know, those certain blockbuster classic ass movies. But then you got these movies that are coming in now and making $1 billion just on a whim, and they're doing it consistently. Like 3, 4, 5 movies are making well over $1 billion. And now, I guess, I don't want to say that you're jealous, but you're looking at it like, hey, what about me? Don't forget about me. Like, you want to, I guess, still have your name in the hat when it comes to, I guess, greatest movies. Like, I guess they feel like they're being overshadowed in a sense, because when it comes to basketball, a lot of times, right?
Mm-hmm.
When you got like your commentators, like, you know, your Charles Barkley and like your Shaqs or whatever, and they have to criticize, I guess, the players of now, and they'll talk about LeBron, or they'll talk about Dwight Howard, like they'll talk about the players of now, like, oh, they're nothing like when we was back in the day. And a lot of that times that has to do with, I feel like, the contracts that these players are getting now, where sometimes, like, we're not making, you know, $152 million off a 4-year deal. Mm-hmm. Like, I barely got $36 for, like, a 5-year deal type of thing. And I feel like it's just
the envy. Older.
Yeah, I really feel like it's envy. I feel like it's really the older crowd feeling like they wish they got in on this type of thing instead of like they got in on the cutting room floor and they paved the way for a lot of these people now. But I feel like they wish they're getting the attention and the accolades and all this stuff that they're getting with what these new filmmakers are getting now.
I get that. I mean, that's definitely something you see in a million different aspects of life. You know, the people is like, oh, well, why do they get all that? Like, I was out here busting my ass too. It's like, if something good happens for someone else, they ask, why didn't that happen to me? Instead of, exactly. Oh, good for them.
Because, you know? I don't really think, because if you were to ask me, I don't think that there's a movie, like a Marvel movie, that is better than, you know, a Casino or Goodfellas. Goodfellas. I think if I was to put those two together on what I would rather watch on like a, you know, like a day where I'm not doing anything, put on Goodfellas. Put mm-hmm. on, you know, Casino. Put on, you know, Scarface. Put on, like,
don't you feel like it's kind of like an apples to oranges comparison, though? Because it's such different, you know, types of movies.
It, at times, but I guess Scorsese is looking at it as just a movie, cinema. He's just looking at it as that, like, yo, I don't want to be overshadowed by, you know, this shit that's supposedly for kids. I think that's another thing, too. He thinks that this is like some goofy shit. This is some shit that's primarily for kids, or like supposed to be for kids. And then they're making all this money. Why didn't my movies make all this money? I really think it's envy and jealousy. I don't really think it's anything but that.
Well, the one point he did make was that because those movies, you know, the movie companies are so averse to taking any kind of risk with a movie, mm-hmm. they're not actually making the types of movies that other, you know, more independent filmmakers would make. You know what I mean? Like, they want to make the big blockbusters that they know they're going to make a ton of money at, instead right. of making, you know, maybe a smaller budget movie, something that they, and, you know, they're giving the director, the artist, you know, a free will in terms of what they, free reign, what they could do and make the movie, let them have creative control. Because, you know, we all know that with Marvel, like, there's a larger story, so they have to hit certain notes in the story arc. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, the directors don't really have free reign, so to speak.
I mean, they do. They just have to make good, compelling shit that can, I guess, compete with this. Because I like to compare this to music a lot of times, because people think that, you know, I guess the mumble rap era is taking over and nobody wants to hear, like, real lyrics anymore. I'm like, no, J. Cole and Kendrick and Wale and Big Crit are still out here thriving. But these mumble rappers are making a lot of money for now.
Yeah.
But people never forget, like, the classics. Like, lyrics have never gone out of style. Those classic gangster movies never gone out of style. It just has anyone made anything that has, that is compelling visually, storyline? They didn't use the same five actors. They didn't, you know, recycle the storyline. It's not the same, you know, I guess, storyline over and over again. Did you bring something new to the table? Is it compelling? Is it refreshing? With these Marvel movies, it's just following a timeline, and every character, it just brings something different. Mm-hmm. With these gangster and mob movies, it's basically the same thing, and it ends up the same way.
That's funny.
To the top, and then they die at the end.
Yeah, that's funny, because Scorsese's saying, like, oh, that's basically they're making the same movie over and over. It's like, bro, what have you done? The Departed, Goodfellas, Casino, now The Irishman. They're all, like, it's all mob movies, and like, most of the people end up dying or getting thrown to jail. Like, it, that's, you know, pot calling the kettle black.
Mm-hmm. But I don't know. Scorsese's just old, you know, old man. Jealousy.
And plus, he said, like, I tried to watch him and I couldn't. Like, wait, so motherfucker, you didn't even watch them? Like, there's 23 movies here. How can you label them all, like, you know, not cinema? Have you watched them all? Like,
yeah, have you watched them all? And then they're probably not for you. Like, if that's not the type of thing that you're into, you're not going to make that. Like, I don't think that Scorsese is going to watch a Marvel movie and suddenly get inspired to make his own comic book movies. That's just not. Because if you wanted to, you would have already. You would have been a director on, like, a Batman. You would have
a director. He was originally supposed to direct Joker, right?
Was he?
He was originally, he was kind of going back and forth on, he was, like, signed on to be the director of Joker before Todd Phillips came on.
Hmm.
I remember them talking about that, like, almost 2 years ago.
I mean, yeah, if you wanted to make a splash in this comic book realm, then you should have took the chance. I don't know what happened. I don't know if it was something on his side or something with the company, but if you wanted that chance to, I guess, you know, show up the Marvels and show up these comic book movies, you had your chance with Joker, but I don't know the particulars of what happened, but you had your shot, you missed it. I don't know. Go back to making mob movies.
Yeah.
Make some dope, man.
You mentioned something too about music, like with mumble rappers being big now. It's kind of like Charlamagne was talking about this. I feel like it's like over a year ago, but he was saying that, like, Drake has been the kind of on top of the game for so long consistently, and they were trying to pick apart, like, why that might be. And it's like, well, think about every time, like, a new thing comes about, like when Migos first started blowing up, like, what did Drake do instead of being like, you know, hating on them and saying, like, you know, that's not real shit. Like, it's mumble rap. I don't want to have anything to do with it. He did a song with them. Like, he fucked with him. He had Kendrick, you know, I guess, do one of the interludes on Take Care.
Mm-hmm.
He did a thing with J. Cole way back when he did the Comeback Season mixtape.
Right.
Like, he was already with these guys. Like, he's not afraid of the new class below him. You know what I'm saying?
And, like, it's also the fact that you're not going to stop this wave from coming. It's going to come whether you like it or not. You're either going to be a part of it or you're going to get swept away in it.
Yep.
It's better for you to just, you know, accept that the times are changing. Nobody wants to see the same as mob movies anymore, or you need to readapt them. You need to do something different, or you just get on the Marvel train and you know what? I'm going to try my hand at this Joker movie. I'm going to try my hand at this Marvel thing. I'm going to try my hand at this, you know, Valiant comic, you know, Dark Horse movie. I don't know, something. All you have to do is to try it. If it's not your thing, it's not your thing, but you tried it. You're not even trying. You're just looking from the outside and then criticizing something that's making billions of dollars.
Yeah. Evolve or die.
Exactly.
All right, bro. I'm glad we got to talk about that. I've been trying to talk about that for like 3 weeks, and I kept forgetting to put it on the list. And it's actually perfect now. because I'm talking to somebody who actually knows what they're talking about.
Right, right. Well,
let's put a pin in it there. We're already at almost an hour 20, so.
Okay.
Brother, I'm so happy you agreed to do this, man. This has been a lot of fun, and I'm really happy we got a chance to talk.
Yeah, me too, man. This is a long time coming, man. Like I said, I've been a fan of the show for like a couple months now when I actually started listening. Mm-hmm. And not just, you know, because a lot of times I have the tendency to like listen and turn it off, and then I get wrapped up in some other work that I'm doing. But now that I'm actually like, you know, I'm going to sit down and listen to this shit. Now I'm an actual fan, and I like the conversation that you're having. So I'm glad to be a part of this like roster of guests that you have on the show, man.
Thank you, man. I really appreciate that. That means a lot. Mm-hmm. You guys were one of the shows that inspired me to do this. So, you know, this is, I feel like it's coming full circle now.
That's fucking nuts, man. I'm inspiring people. That's fucking nuts, man. I'm always humbled by that, man. And like I said, all the time I tell you in private, but like, thank you for listening and always supporting us, man. Always sharing the show, always talking about us, man. It really makes me feel good that someone other than like people I actually like know, like it's crazy for people that I haven't met in person, people that I know only online, mm-hmm. to support us the way that they do. And man, I can't tell you how much that means to me, man.
Hey man, you guys make it easy. You guys make good stuff. So I'm happy to share it.
Thank you, man.
All right. So why don't you let the people know where they can find you?
All right. Where you can find me, on Instagram and Twitter at HK_Domino. You can find the Domino Effect Podcast on SoundCloud, iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher. That's Domino Effect Pod on Twitter, Domino_Effect_Podcast on Instagram, and Three Ninjas Podcast. You can find that on SoundCloud, iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, Spotify, YouTube, iHeartRadio, wherever the fuck you get your podcast, we are there. Three Ninjas Podcast @gmail.com. If you want to write us for anything, you know, we answer your questions, whether they be geek related or they be about just regular life shit. Three Ninjas Podcast on Instagram and Twitter as well. ThreeNinjasPodcast.com. If you want to, you know, check out our merch and check out anything that we got going on, any events we got coming up, you can find out all the information there as well as our social media pages. But that's where you can primarily find us and me as well.
All right, brother. You guys heard it here. We had him here, the real man, the Bulbasaur ambassador. Dreddy Krueger. Oh, you know, man, who it is. I tell you, man, I had a whole list of those made up, and I'm like, you know what? I can't do this. I'm ripping off these guys. That's not my thing. It could be fun to call myself the pimp hand of the king, but
the king of the North Face.
Yeah, a Roku Saki bomb.
Right. See.
I had a bunch, bro. I had a bunch.
I was thinking of a good Oroku Saki one, but I can't think of one.
That was that used to be my gamer tag on Xbox Live.
Oroku Saki bomb? Yeah,
or no, just Oroku Saki.
Oh, okay. Damn, you took my shit, see?
All right, people. Everywhere he said you could find Three Ninjas and Domino Effect, you could find A Pod Amongst Men, too. That's not me ripping them off. That's just those are the places to find it. But you right. know that. yeah, you know where to find us at A Pod Amongst Men on Instagram, apodamongstmen@gmail.com. With any comments, you want any advice, anything you got, reach out to us. We'll be happy to hit you back. So until next week, thanks a lot, people. Peace.